The following is a free-for-download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Part 3, Chapter 24, The Renunciation of Kardama Muni. Text 1. Recalling the words of Lord Vishnu, the merciful sage Kardama replied as follows to Svayambhuva Manu's praiseworthy daughter, Devahuti, who was speaking words full of renunciation. Text 2. The sage said, "Do not be disappointed with yourself, O princess. You are actually praiseworthy. The infallible Supreme Personality of Godhead will shortly enter your womb as your son." Purport. Kardama Muni encouraged his wife not to be sorry, thinking herself unfortunate, because the Supreme Personality of Godhead, by his incarnation, was going to come from her body. Text 3. "You have undertaken sacred vows. God will bless you. Hence you should worship the Lord with great faith through sense control, religious observances, austerities, and gifts of your money and charity." Purport. In order to be spiritually advanced or to achieve the mercy of the Lord, one must be self-controlled in the following manner. He must be restrained in sense gratification and must follow the rules and regulations of religious principles. Without austerity and penance, and without sacrificing one's riches, one cannot achieve the mercy of the Supreme Lord. Kardama Muni advised his wife, "You have to factually engage in devotional service with austerity and penance, following the religious principles and giving in charity. Then the Supreme Lord will be pleased with you, and he will come as your son." End quote. Text 4. "The Supreme Personality of Godhead, being worshipped by you, will spread my name and fame. He will vanquish the knot of your heart by becoming your son and teaching knowledge of Brahman." Purport. When the Supreme Personality of Godhead comes to disseminate spiritual knowledge for the benefit of all people, he generally descends as the son of a devotee, being pleased by the devotee's devotional service. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is the father of everyone. No one, therefore, is his father, but by his inconceivable energy, he accepts some of the devotees as his parents and descendants. It is explained here that spiritual knowledge vanquishes the knot in the heart. Matter and spirit are knotted by false ego. This identification of oneself with matter, which is called Hridaya Granthi, exists for all conditioned souls, and it becomes more and more tightened when there is too much affection for sex life. The explanation was given by Lord Rishabha to his sons that this material world is an atmosphere of attraction between male and female. That attraction takes the shape of a knot in the heart, and by material affection it becomes still more tight. For people who hanker after material possessions, society, friendship, and love, this knot of affection becomes very strong. It is only by Brahma Bhavana, the instruction by which spiritual knowledge is enhanced, that the knot in the heart is cut to pieces. No material weapon is needed to cut this knot, but it requires bona fide spiritual instruction. Kardama Muni instructed his wife, Devahuti, that the Lord would appear as her son to disseminate knowledge to cut the knot of material identification. Text 5. Sri Maitreya said, "Devahuti was fully faithful and respectful toward the direction of her husband Kardama, who is one of the Prajapatis, or generators of human beings in the universe. O great sage, she thus began to worship the master of the universe, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is situated in everyone's heart." Purport. This is the process of spiritual realization. One has to receive instruction from a bona fide spiritual master. Although Kardama Muni was Devahuti's husband, because he instructed her on how to achieve spiritual perfection, he naturally became her spiritual master also. There are many instances wherein the husband becomes the spiritual master. Lord Shiva also is the spiritual master of his consort, Parvati. A husband should be so enlightened that he should become the spiritual master of his wife in order to enlighten her in advancement of Krishna consciousness. Generally, stree, or woman, is less intelligent than man. Therefore, if the husband is intelligent enough, the woman gets the opportunity for spiritual enlightenment. Here it is clearly said, samyakshadaya, that with great faith one should receive knowledge from the spiritual master and with great faith execute the performance of service. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur, in his commentary on Bhagavad Gita, has especially stressed the instruction of the spiritual master. One should accept the instruction of the spiritual master as one's life and soul. Whether one is liberated or not liberated, he should execute the instruction of the spiritual master with great faith. It is also stated that the Lord is situated in everyone's heart. One doesn't have to seek the Lord outside. He is already there. One simply has to concentrate on his worship in good faith, as instructed by the bona fide spiritual master, and his efforts will come out successful. It is also clear that the Supreme Personality of Godhead does not appear as an ordinary child. He appears as he is. As stated in Bhagavad Gita, he appears by his own internal potency, Atma Maya. And how does he appear? He appears when pleased by the worship of a devotee. A devotee may ask the Lord to appear as her son. The Lord is already sitting within the heart, and if he comes out of the body of a devotee, it does not mean that the particular woman becomes his mother in the material sense. He is always there, but in order to please his devotee, he appears as her son. Text 6. After many, many years, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Madhusudana, the killer of the demon Madhu, having entered the Semana of Kardama, appeared in Devahuti, just as fire comes from wood in a sacrifice. Purport. It is clearly stated here that the Lord is always the Supreme Personality of Godhead, although he appears as the son of Kardama Muni. Fire is always present in wood, but by certain process, fire is kindled. Similarly, God is all-pervading. He is everywhere, and since he may come out from anything, everything, he appeared in the devotee's semina. Just as an ordinary living entity takes his birth by taking shelter of the semina of a certain living entity, similarly, the Supreme Personality of Godhead accepts the shelter of the semina of his devotee and comes out as his son. This manifests his full independence to act in any way, and it does not mean that he is an ordinary living entity forced to take birth in a certain type of womb. Lord Nrisimha appeared from the pillar of Hiranyakashipu's palace. Lord Varaha appeared from the nostril of Brahma, and Lord Kapila appeared from the semina of Kardama, but this does not mean that the nostril of Brahma or the pillar of Hiranyakashipu's palace or the semina of Kardama Muni is the source of the appearance of the Lord. The Lord is always the Lord. Bhagavan Madhusudana, he is the killer of all kinds of demons, and he always remains the Lord, even if he appears as the son of a particular devotee. The word Kardamam is significant, for it indicates that the Lord had some devotional affection or relationship in devotional service with Kardamam and Devahuti. But we should not mistakenly understand that he was born just like an ordinary living entity from the semina of Kardama Muni in the womb of Devahuti. Text 7. At the time of his descent on earth, demigods in the form of raining clouds and sounded musical instruments in the sky. The celestial musicians, the Gandharvas, sang the glories of the Lord, while celestial dancing girls, known as Apsaras, danced in joyful ecstasy. Text 8. At that time of the Lord's experience, the demigods flying freely in the sky showered flowers. All the directions, all the waters, and everyone's mind became very satisfied. Purport. It is learned herein that in the higher sky there are living entities who can travel through the air without being hampered. Although we can travel in outer space, we are hampered by so many impediments, but they are not. We learn from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam that the inhabitants of the planet called Siddhaloka can travel in space from one planet to another without impediment. They showered flowers on the earth when Lord Kapila, the son of Kardama, appeared. Text 9. Brahma, the firstborn living being, went along with Marichi and other sages to the place of Kardama's hermitage, which was surrounded by the river Saraswati. Purport. Brahma is called Svayambhu because he is not born of any material father or mother. He is the first living creature and is born from the lotus which grows from the abdomen of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Garbhodakshayi Vishnu. Therefore, he is called Svayambhu, self-born. Text 10. Maitreya continued, O killer of the enemy, the unborn Lord Brahma, who is almost independent of an inquiring knowledge, could understand that a portion of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his quality of pure existence had appeared in the womb of Devahuti just to explain the complete state of knowledge known as Shankhya Yoga. Purport. In Bhagavad Gita 15th chapter, it is stated that the Lord himself is the compiler of Vedanta Sutra, and he is the perfect knower of Vedanta Sutra. Similarly, the Shankhya philosophy is compiled by the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his appearance as Kapila. There is an imitation Kapila who has a Shankhya philosophical system, but Kapila, the incarnation of God, is different from that Kapila. Kapila, the son of Kardama Muni, in his system of Shankhya philosophy, very explicitly explained not only the material world, but also the spiritual world. Brahma could understand this fact because he is Svarat, almost independent in receiving knowledge. He is called Svarat because he did not go to any school or college to learn anything, but learned everything from within. Because Brahma is the first living creature within this universe, he had no teacher. His teacher was the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, who is seated in the heart of every living creature. Brahma acquired knowledge directly from the Supreme Lord within the heart. Therefore, he is sometimes called Svarat and Aja. Another important point is stated here. Sattvanam Sena. When the Supreme Personality of Godhead appears, he brings with him all his paraphernalia of Vaikuntha. Therefore, his name, his form, his quality, his paraphernalia, and his entourage all belong to the transcendental world. Real goodness is in the transcendental world. Here in the material world, the quality of goodness is not pure. Goodness may exist, but there must also be some tinges of passion and ignorance. In the spiritual world, the unalloyed good quality of goodness prevails. There, the quality of goodness is called sattva-gun, or sudha-sattva, pure goodness. Another name for sudha-sattva is Vasudev, because God is born from Vasudev. Another meaning is that when one is purely situated in the qualities of goodness, he can understand the form, name, quality, paraphernalia, and entourage of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The word Amsena also indicates that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, appeared as Kapiladev in his portion of the portion. God expands either as Kala or Amsa. Amsa means direct expansion, and Kala means expansion of the expansion. So there is no difference between the expansion and the Supreme Personality of Godhead directly. Just as there is no difference between one candle and another, but still the candle from which the others are lit is called the original. Krishna, therefore, is called the Parabrahman, the ultimate Godhead and the cause of all causes. Text 11. After worshiping the Supreme Lord with gladdened senses and a pure heart for intended activities as an incarnation, Brahma spoke as follows to Kardama and Devahuti. Purport. As explained in Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, anyone who understands the transcendental activities, appearance, and disappearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead is to be considered liberated. Brahma, therefore, is a liberated soul. Although he is in charge of this material world, he is not exactly like the common living entity. Since he is liberated from the majority of the follies of the common living entities, he was in knowledge of the appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and he therefore worshipped the Lord's activities, and with a glad heart he also praised Kardama Muni because the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as Kapila, appeared as his son. One who can become the father of the Supreme Personality of Godhead is certainly a great devotee. There is a verse spoken by a Brahmana in which he says that he does not know what the Vedas and the Puranas are, But while others might be interested in the Vedas and Puranas, he is interested in Nanda Maharaj, who appeared as the father of Krishna. He wanted to worship Nanda Maharaj because the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as a child, crawled in the yard of his house. These are some of the good sentiments of devotees. If a recognized devotee brings forth the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his son, how should he be praised? Brahma, therefore, not only worshipped the incarnation of Godhead Kapila, but he praised his so-called father, Kardama Muni. Text 12. Lord Brahma said, "My dear son, Kardama, since you have completely accepted my instructions without duplicity, showing them proper respect, you have worshipped me properly. Whatever instructions you took from me, you have carried out, and thereby you have honored me." Purport. Lord Brahma, as the first living entity within the universe, is supposed to be the spiritual master of everyone, and he is also the father, the creator of all beings. Kardama Muni is one of the Prajapatis, or creators of the living entities, but he is also a son of Brahma. Brahma praises Kardama because he carried out the orders of the spiritual master in toto and without cheating. A conditioned soul in the material world has the disqualification of cheating. He has four disqualifications. He is sure to commit mistakes. He is sure to be illusioned. He is prone to cheat others, and his senses are imperfect. But if anyone carries out the order of the spiritual master by disciplic succession or the parampara system, he overcomes the four defects. Therefore, knowledge received from the bona fide spiritual master is not cheating. Any other knowledge which is manufactured by the conditioned soul is cheating only. Brahma knew well that Kardama Muni exactly carried out the instructions received from him and that he actually honored his spiritual master. To honor the spiritual master means to carry out his instructions word for word. Text 13. Sons ought to render service to their father exactly to this extent. One should obey the command of his father or spiritual master with due deference, saying, "Yes, sir." Purport. Two words in this verse are very important. The one is pitari, and another word is guru. The son or disciple should accept the words of his spiritual master and father without hesitation. Whatever the father and the spiritual master order should be taken without argument, quote, "yes," end quote. There should be no instance in which the disciple or the son says, quote, "this is not correct, I cannot carry it out," end quote. When he says that, he is fallen. The father and the spiritual master are on the same platform because the spiritual master is the second father. The higher classes are called dvija, twice born. Whenever there is a question of birth, there must be a father. First birth is made possible by the actual father, and the second birth is made possible by the spiritual master. Sometimes the father and the spiritual master may be the same men, and sometimes they are different men. In any case, the order of the father and the order of the spiritual master must be carried out without hesitation, with an immediate yes. There should be no argument. That is the real service to the father and the spiritual master. Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has stated that the order of the spiritual master is the life and soul of the disciples. As a man cannot separate his life from his body, so a disciple cannot separate the order of the spiritual master from his life. If a disciple follows the instruction of the spiritual master in that way, he is sure to become perfect. This is confirmed in the Upanishads. The import of the Vedic instruction is revealed automatically only to one who has implicit faith in the Supreme Personality of Godhead and in his spiritual master. One may be materially considered an illiterate man, but if he has faith in the spiritual master as well as in the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then the meaning of spiritual revelation is immediately manifested before him. Text 14. Lord Brahma then praised Kardama Muni's nine daughters, saying, "All your thin-waisted daughters are certainly very chaste. I am sure they will increase this creation by their own descendants in various ways." Purport. In the beginning of creation, Brahma was concerned more or less with increasing the population, and when he saw that Kardama Muni had already begotten 9 nice daughters, he was hopeful that through the daughters many children would come who would take charge of the creative principles of the material world. He was therefore happy to see them. The words Suma Dhyama means a good daughter of a beautiful woman. If she has a thin waist, a woman is considered very beautiful. All the daughters of Kardama Muni were of the same beautiful feature. Text 15. Therefore, today, please give away your daughters to the foremost of the sages, and with due respect for the girls' temperaments and likings, and thereby spread your fame all over the universe. Purport. The 9 principal rishis, or sages, are Marichi, Atri, Angira, Pulastya, Pulaha, Kratu, Bhrigu, Vasishta, and Atharva. All these rishis are most important, and Brahma desired that the 9 daughters already born to Kardama Muni be handed over to them. The 2 words used are very significant, Yuta Shilam and Yataruchi. The daughters should be handed over to the respective rishis, not blindly, but according to the combination of character and taste. That is the art of combining a man and a woman. Man and woman should not be united simply on the consideration of sex life. There are many other considerations, especially character and taste. If the taste and character differ between the man and woman, their combination will be unhappy. Even about 40 years ago in Indian marriages, the taste and character of the boy and girl were first of all matched, and then they were allowed to marry. This was done under the direction of the respective parents. The parents used to astrologically determine the character and tastes of the boy and girl, and when they corresponded, the match was selected. Quote, this girl and this boy are just suitable, and they should be married, end quote. Such other considerations were less important. The same system is also advised in the beginning of the creation by Brahma. Quote, your daughters should be handed over to the rishis according to taste and character, end quote. According to astrological calculation, a person is classified according to whether or not he belongs to the godly or demoniac quality. In that way, the spouse was selected. A girl of godly quality should be handed over to a boy of godly quality. A girl of demoniac quality should be handed over to a boy of demoniac quality. Then they will be happy. But if the girl is demoniac and the boy is godly, then the combination is incompatible. They cannot be happy in such a marriage. At the present moment, because the boys and girls are not married according to quality and character, most marriages are unhappy, and there is divorce. It is foretold in the 12th canto of Bhagavatam that in this age of Kali, married life will be accepted only on the consideration of sex life. And when the boy and girls are pleased in sex, they get married, but when there is deficiency in sex, they separate. That is not actual marriage, but a combination of men and women, like cats and dogs. Therefore, the children produced in the modern age are not exactly human beings. Human beings must be twice born. A child is first born of a good father and mother, and then he must be born again of the spiritual master in the Vedas. The first father and mother bring about his birth into this world. Then, the spiritual master in the Vedas become his second father and mother. According to this Vedic system of marriage for producing children, every man and woman was enlightened in spiritual knowledge, and at the time of their combination to produce a child, everything was scrutinizingly and scientifically done. Text 16. O Kardama, I know that the original Supreme Personality of Godhead has now appeared as an incarnation by his internal energy. He is the bestower of all desired by the living entities, and he has now assumed the body of Kapila Muni. Purport. In this verse, we find the words Purusham Avatinam Svamayaya. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is everlastingly, eternally, the form of Purusha, the predominator or enjoyer, and when he appears, he never accepts anything of this material energy. The spiritual world is a manifestation of his personal internal potency, whereas the material world is a manifestation of his material or differentiated energy. The word Svamayaya, by his own internal potency, indicates that whenever the Supreme Personality of Godhead descends, he comes in his own energy. He may assume the body of a human being, but that body is not material. In Bhagavad Gita, therefore, it is clearly stated that only fools and rascals, mudhas, consider the body of Krishna to be the body of a common human being. The word sevadim means that he is the original bestower of all the necessities of life upon the living entities. In the Vedas, it is stated that he is the chief living entity and he bestows all the desired necessities of other living entities. Because he is the bestower of the necessities of all others, he is called God. The Supreme is also a living entity. He is not impersonal. As we are individuals, so the Supreme Personality of Godhead is also individual, but he is the supreme individual. That is the difference between God and the ordinary living entities. Text 17. By mystic yoga and the practical application of knowledge from the scriptures, Kapila Muni, who is characterized by his golden hair, his eyes, just like lotus petals, and his lotus feet, which bear the marks of lotus flowers, will uproot the deep desire for work in this material world. Purport. In this verse, the activities and bodily features of Kapila Muni are very nicely described. The activities of Kapila Muni are forecast herein. He will present the philosophy of Shankya in such a way that by studying his philosophy, people will be able to uproot the deep-rooted desire for karma, fruit of activities. Everyone in this material world engages in achieving the fruits of his labor. A man tries to be happy by achieving the fruits of his own honest labor, but actually he becomes more and more entangled. One cannot get out of this entanglement unless he has perfect knowledge or devotional service. Those who are trying to get out of the entanglement by speculation are also doing their best, but in the Vedic scriptures we find that anyone who has taken to the devotional service of the Lord in Krishna consciousness, he can very easily uproot the deep-rooted desire for fruitive activities. Shankya philosophy will be broadcast by Kapila Muni for that purpose. His bodily features are also described herein. Gyan does not refer to ordinary research work. Gyan entails receiving knowledge from the scriptures through the spiritual master by disciplic succession. In the modern age, there is a tendency to do research by mental speculation and concoction, but the man who speculates forgets that he himself is subject to the four defects of nature. He is sure to commit mistakes, his senses are imperfect, he is sure to fall into illusion, and he is cheating. Unless one has perfect knowledge from disciplic succession, he simply puts forth some theories of his own creations, therefore he is cheating people. Gyan means knowledge received through disciplic succession from the scriptures, and Bigyan means practical application of such knowledge. Kapila Muni's Shankya system of philosophy is based on Gyan and Vigyan. Text 18. Lord Brahma then told Devahuti, "My dear daughter of Manu, the same Supreme Personality of Godhead who killed the demon Kaitaba is now within your womb. He will cut off all the knots of your ignorance and doubt. Then he will travel all over the world." Purport. Here the word avidya is very significant. Avidya means forgetfulness of one's own identity. Every one of us is a spirit soul, but we have forgotten. We think, "I am this body." This is called avidya. Samsaya granti means doubtfulness. The knot of doubtfulness is tied when the soul identifies with the material world. That knot is called ahankar, the junction of matter and spirit. By proper knowledge received from the scriptures in disciplic succession, and by proper application of that knowledge, one can free himself from this binding combination of matter and spirit. Brahma assures Devahuti that her son will enlighten her, and after enlightening her, he will travel all over the world, distributing the system of Shankya philosophy. The word samshaya means doubtful knowledge. Speculative and pseudo-yogic knowledge is all doubtful. At the present moment, the so-called yoga system is prosecuted on the understanding that by agitation of the different situations or stations of the bodily construction, then one can find that he is God. The mental speculators think similarly, but they are all doubtful. Real knowledge is expounded in Bhagavad Gita, quote, just become Krishna conscious, just worship Krishna and become a devotee of Krishna, end quote. That is real knowledge, and anyone who follows that system becomes perfect without a doubt. Text 19. Your son will be the head of all the perfected souls. He will be approved by the acharyas, expert in disseminating real knowledge, and among these people he will be celebrated by the name Kapila. As the son of Devahuti, he will increase your fame. Purport. Shankya philosophy is the philosophical system enunciated by Kapila, the son of Devahuti. The other Kapila, who is not the son of Devahuti, is an imitation. This is the statement of Brahma. And because we belong to the Brahma's disciplic succession, we should accept his statement as the real Kapila is the son of the Devahuti, and that real Shankya philosophy is the system of philosophy which he introduced and which will be accepted by the acharyas, the directors of spiritual discipline. The word shushamata means accepted by persons who are counted upon to give their good opinion. Text 20. Sri Maitreya said, after thus speaking to Gardama Muni and his wife, Devahuti, Lord Brahma, the creator of the universe, who is also known as Hamsa, went back to the highest of the three planetary systems on his swan carrier with the four Kumaras and Narada. Purport. The word Hamsena Yanena are very significant here. Hamsa Yana, the airplane by which Brahma travels all over outer space, resembles a swan. Hamsa is also known as Hamsa, or Brahma is also known as Hamsa, because he can grasp the essence of everything. His abode is called Tridhama Paramam. There are three divisions of the universe, upper planetary system, middle planetary system, and the lower planetary system. But his abode is above even Siddhaloka, the upper planetary system. He returned to his own planet with the four Kumars and Narada because they were not going to be married. The other rishis who came with him, such as Marichi and Natri, remained there because they were to be married to the daughters of Kardama. But his other sons, Sanat, Sanaka, Sanandana, Sanatana, and Narada, went back with him in his swan-shaped airplane. The four Kumars and Narada are Naishtika Brahmacharis. Naishtika Brahmachari means one who never wastes his samana at any time. They were not to attend the marriage ceremony of their older brothers, Marichi and the other sages, and therefore they went back with their father, Hamsa. Text 21. O Vidura, after the departure of Brahma, Kardama Muni, having been ordered by Brahma, handed over his nine daughters as instructed to the nine great sages who created the population of the world. Text 22 and 23. Kardama Muni handed over his daughter Kala to Marichi and another daughter, Anasuya, to Atri. He delivered Shraddha to Angira and Havirbhu to Pulastya. He delivered Gati to Pulaha, the chaste Kriya to Kratu, Kyati to Brighu, and Arundhati to Vishishta. Text 24. He delivered Shanti to Atharva. Because of Shanti, sacrificial ceremonies are well performed. Thus, he got the foremost brahmanas married, and he maintained them along with their wives. Text 25. Thus married, the sages took leave of Kardama and departed, full of joy, each for his own hermitage, O Vidura. Text 26. When Kardama Muni understood that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the chief of all the demigods, Vishnu, had descended, he approached him in a secluded place, offered obeisances, and spoke as follows. Purport. Lord Vishnu is called Triyuga. He appears in three yugas, Satya, Treta, and Dwapara, but in Kali Yuga he does not appear. From the prayers of Prahlad Maharaj, however, we understand that he appeared garbed as a devotee in Kali Yuga. Lord Chaitanya is that devotee. Krishna appeared in the form of a devotee, but although he never disclosed himself, Rupa Goswami could understand his identity, for the Lord cannot hide himself from a pure devotee. Rupa Goswami detected him when he first offered his obeisances to Lord Chaitanya. He knew that he was Krishna himself, and therefore he offered his obeisances with the following words, quote, "Offer my respects to Krishna, who has now appeared as Lord Chaitanya," end quote. This is also confirmed in the prayers of Prahlad Maharaj. In Kali Yuga, he does not directly appear, but he appears as a devotee. Vishnu, therefore, is known as Triyuga. Another explanation of Triyuga is that he has three pairs of divine attributes, namely power and affluence, piety and renown, and wisdom and dispassion. According to Sridhar Swami, his three pairs of opulences are complete riches and complete strength, complete fame and complete beauty, and complete wisdom and complete renunciation. There are different interpretations of Triyuga, but it is accepted by all learned scholars that Triyuga means Vishnu. When Kardama Muni understood that his son, Kapila, was Vishnu himself, he wanted to offer his obeisances. Therefore, when Kapila was alone, he offered his respects and expressed his mind as follows. Text 27. Kardama Muni said, "Oh, after a long time, the demigods of this universe have become pleased with the suffering souls who are materially entangled because of their own misdeeds." Purport. This material world is a place for suffering, which is due to the misdeeds of the inhabitants, the conditioned souls themselves. The sufferings are not extraneously imposed upon them. Rather, they create their own suffering by their own acts. In the forest, fire automatically takes place. It is not that someone has to go there and set a fire, but because of friction among various trees, fire occurs automatically. When there is too much heat from the forest fire of this material world, the demigods, including Brahma himself, being harassed, approach the Supreme Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and appeal to him to alleviate the condition. Then the Supreme Personality of Godhead descends. In other words, when the demigods become distressed by the sufferings of the conditioned souls, they approach the Lord to remedy the suffering, and the Personality of Godhead descends. When the Lord descends, all the demigods become enlivened. Therefore, Kardama Muni said, quote, "After many, many years of human suffering, all the demigods are now satisfied because Kapila Dev, the incarnation of Godhead, has appeared." Text 28. After many births, mature yogis, by complete trance and yoga, endeavor in secluded places to see the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Purport. Some important things are mentioned here about yoga. The word Bahu Janma Vipak Vena means after many, many births of mature yoga practice. And another word, Samyag Yoga Samadhina, means by complete practice of the yoga system. Complete practice of yoga means bhakti yoga. Unless one comes to the point of bhakti yoga, or surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one's yoga practice is not complete. This same point is corroborated in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Bahanam Janmanamante. After many, many births, the jnani, who has matured in transcendental knowledge, surrenders unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Kardama Muni repeats the same statement. After many, many years and many, many births of complete practice of yoga, one can see the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord in a secluded place. It is not that after one practices some sitting postures, he immediately becomes perfect. One has to perform yoga for a long time, quote, many, many births, end quote, to become mature. And a yogi has to practice in a secluded place. One cannot practice yoga in a city or in a public park and declare that he has become God simply by some exchange of dollars. This is all bogus propaganda. Those who are actually yogis practice in a secluded place, and after many, many births, they become successful, provided they surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which is the completion of yoga. Text 29. Not considering the negligence of ordinary householders like us, that very same Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared in our homes just to support his devotees. Purport. Devotees are so affectionate toward the personality of Godhead that although he does not appear before those who practice yoga in a secluded place, even for many, many births, he agrees to appear in a householder's home where devotees engage in devotional service without material yoga practice. In other words, devotional service to the Lord is so easy that even a householder can see the Supreme Personality of Godhead as one of the members of his household, as his son, as Kardama Muni experienced. He was a householder, although a yogi, but he had the incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Kapila Muni, as his son. Devotional service is such a powerful transcendental method that it surpasses all other methods of transcendental realization. The Lord says, therefore, that he lives neither in Vaikuntha nor in the heart of a yogi, but he lives where his pure devotees are always chanting and glorifying him. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is known as Bhakta Vatsal. He is never described as Gyani Vatsal or Yogi Vatsal. He is always described as Bhakta Vatsal because he is more inclined toward his devotees than towards other transcendentalists. In Bhagavad Gita, it is confirmed that only a devotee can understand him as he is. Bhakti Mam Abhijananti, quote, one can understand me only by devotional service, not otherwise, end quote. That understanding alone is real, because although jnanis, mental speculators, can realize only the effulgence of the bodily luster of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the yogis can realize only the partial representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, a bhakta not only realizes him as he is, but he also associates with this personality of Godhead face to face. Text 30. Kardama Muni said, my dear Lord, you who are always increasing the honor of your devotees have descended in my home just to fulfill your word and disseminate the process of real knowledge. Purport. When the Lord appeared before Kardama Muni after his mature yoga practice, he promised that he would become his son. He descended as the son of Kardama Muni in order to fulfill that promise. Another purpose of his appearance is Chikishur Bhagavan Gyanam, to distribute knowledge. Therefore, he is called Bhaktanan Maha Armana Vardana, he who increases the honor of his devotees. By distributing Shankhya, he would increase the honor of the devotees. Therefore, Shankhya philosophy is not dry mental speculation. Shankhya philosophy means devotional service. How could the honor of the devotees be increased unless Shankhya were meant for devotional service? Devotees are not interested in speculative knowledge. Therefore, the Shankhya enunciated by Kapila Muni is meant to establish one firmly in devotional service. Real knowledge and real liberation is to surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead and engage in devotional service. Text 31. My dear Lord, although you have no eternal material form, you have your own innumerable forms. They are truly your transcendental forms, which are pleasing to your devotees. Purport. In the Brahma Samhita, it is stated that the Lord is one, absolute, but he has ananta, or innumerable forms, adoitam achutam anadmanantarupam. The Lord is the original form, but still he has multi-forms. Those multi-forms are manifested by him transcendentally according to the tastes of his multi-devotees. It is understood that once Hanuman, the great devotee of Lord Ramchandra, said that he knew that Narayan, the husband of Lakshmi, and Ram, the husband of Sita, are one and the same, and that there is no difference between Lakshmi and Sita. But as for himself, he liked the form of Lord Ram. In a similar way, some devotees worship the original form of Krishna. When we say Krishna, we refer to all forms of the Lord, not only Krishna, but Ram, Narsingha, Varaha, Narayan, etc. The varieties of transcendental forms exist simultaneously. That is also stated in the Brahma Samhita, Ramadi Murtishu Nanavantaram. He already exists in multi-forms, but none of the forms are material. Sridhar Swami has commented that anupina, or without form, means without material form. The Lord has form. Otherwise, how can it be stated here? Tani eva te burirapani rupani bhagavans tava. Quote, you have many forms, but they are not material. Materially, you have no form, but spiritually, transcendentally, you have multiforms. Mayavadi philosophers cannot understand these transcendental forms of the Lord, and being disappointed, they say that the Lord, Supreme Lord, is impersonal. But that is not a fact. Wherever there is a form, there is a person. And many times in many Vedic literatures, the Lord is described as Purusha, which means the original form, the original enjoyer. The conclusion is that the Lord has no material form, and yet, according to the liking of the different grades of devotees, he simultaneously exists in multi-forms such as Ram, Narsingha, Varaha, Narayan, and Mukunda. There are thousands and thousands of forms, but they are all Vishnu Tattva, Krishna. Text 32. My dear Lord, your lotus feet are the reservoir that always deserves to be to receive worshipful homage from all great sages eager to understand the absolute truth. You are full in opulence, renunciation, transcendental fame, knowledge, strength, and beauty, and therefore I surrender myself unto your lotus feet. Purport. Actually, those who are searching after the absolute truth must take shelter of the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and worship him. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna advised Arjuna many times to surrender unto him, especially at the end of the ninth chapter, Manmana Mabama Bhakta. Quote, if you want to be perfect, just always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, and offer your obeisances unto me. In this way, you will understand me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and ultimately you will come back to me, back to Godhead, back home. End quote. Why is it so? The Lord is always full in six opulences, as mentioned herewith. Wealth, renunciation, fame, knowledge, strength, and beauty. The word purtam means full. No one can claim that all wealth belongs to him, but Krishna can claim it since he has full wealth. Similarly, he is full in knowledge, renunciation, strength, and beauty. He is full in everything, and no one can surpass him. Another one of Krishna's name is Asamardva, which means that no one is equal to or greater than him. Text 33. I surrender unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead, descended in the form of Kapila, who is independently powerful and transcendental, who is the Supreme Person and the Lord of the sum total of matter and the element of time, who is the fully cognizant maintainer of all the universes under the three modes of material nature, and who absorbs the material manifestation after their dissolution. Purport. The six opulences, wealth, strength, fame, beauty, knowledge, and renunciation, are indicated here by Kardama Muni, who addresses Kapila Muni, his son, as Param. The word Param is used in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam in this phrase Param Satyam to refer to the summum bonum of, or the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Param is explained further by the next word, Pradhanam, which means the chief, the origin, the source of everything, Sarva Karana Karanam, the cause of all causes. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is not formless. He is Purusham, or the enjoyer, the original person. He is the time element and is all cognizant. He knows everything, past, present, and future, as confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. The Lord says, quote, I know everything, past, present, and future, in every corner of the universe, end quote. The material world, which is moving under the spell of the three modes of nature, is also a manifestation of his energy. Prasya Shaktir Vividaya Shuyati. Everything that we see is an interaction of his energies. Svetata Shratara Upanishad 6.8. Prasya Brahmana Shaktis Tatedam Akilam Jagat. This is the version of the Vishnu Purana. We can understand that whatever we see is an interaction of the three modes of material nature, but actually it is all an interaction of the Lord's energy. Loka Palam. He is actually the maintainer of all living entities. Nityo Nityanam. He is the chief of all living entities. He is one, but he maintains many, many living entities. God maintains all other living entities, but no one can maintain God. That is his Svachanda Shakti. He is not dependent on others. Someone may call himself independent, but he is still dependent on someone higher. The personality of Godhead, however, is absolute. There is no one higher than or equal to him. Kapila Muni appeared as the son of Kardama Muni, but because he is an incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Kardama Muni offers his respectful obeisances unto him with full surrender. Another word in this verse is very important. Atmanu Bhutyatnuga Nutaga Pancham. The Lord descends either as Kapila or Ram and Shringa or Varaha, and whatever forms he assumes in the material world are all manifestations of his own internal, personal internal energy. They are never the forms of the material energy. The ordinary living entities who are manifested in this material world have bodies created by the material energy, but when Krishna or any one of his expansions or parts of the expansions descends on this material world, although he appears to have a material body, his body is not material. He always has a transcendental body. But fools and rascals are called mudhas, consider him one of them, and therefore they deride him. They refuse to accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead because they cannot understand him. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Avajananti ma mudha. Quote, those who are rascals and fools deride me, end quote. When God descends in a form, this does not mean that he assumes his form with the help of the material energy. He manifests his spiritual form as he exists in the spiritual kingdom. Text 34. Today, I have something to ask from you, who are the Lord of all living entities. Since I have now been liberated by you from my debts to my Father, and since all my desires are fulfilled, I wish to accept the order of an itinerant mendicant. Renouncing this family life, I wish to wander about, free from lamentation, thinking always of you in my heart. Purport. Actually, sannyas, or renunciation of material household life, necessitates complete absorption in Krishna consciousness and immersion in the self. If one does not take sannyas, freedom from family responsibility, in the renounced order of life, to make another family or to create an embarrassing transcendental fraud in the name of sannyas. The sannyasi's business is not to become proprietor of so many things and amass money from the innocent public. A sannyasi is proud that he is always thinking of Krishna within himself. Of course, there are two kinds of devotees of the Lord. One is called Goshtinani, which means that those who are preachers and have many followers for preaching the glories of the Lord and who live amongst those many, many followers just to organize missionary activities. Other devotees are Atmanandi, self-satisfied, and they do not take the risk of preaching work. They remain, therefore, alone with God. In this classification was Kardama Muni. He wanted to be freed from all anxieties and remain alone within his heart with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Parivraja means an itinerant mendicant. A mendicant sannyasi should not live anywhere for more than 3 days. He must be always moving because his duty is to move from door to door and enlighten people about Krishna consciousness. Text 35. The Personality of Godhead, Kapila, said, whatever I speak, whether directly or in the scriptures, is authoritative in all respects for the people of the world. O Muni, because I told you before that I would become your son, I have descended to fulfill this truth. Purport. Kardama Muni was to leave his family life to completely engage in the service of the Lord. But since he knew that the Lord himself, as Kapila, had taken birth in his home as his son, why was he preparing to leave home to search out self-realization or God-realization? God himself was present in his home. Why should he leave home? Such a question may certainly arise. But here it is said that whatever is spoken in the Vedas and whatever is practiced is in accordance with the injunctions of the Vedas, is to be accepted as authoritative in society. The Vedic authority says that a householder must leave home after his 50th year. Pancha Sordvam Banam Brajet. One must leave his family life and enter the forest after the age of 50. That is an authoritative statement of the Vedas based on the division of social life into four departments of activity: brahmacharya, grihastha, vanaprastha, and sannyas. Kardama Muni practiced yoga very rigidly as a brahmachari before his marriage, and he became so powerful and attained so much mystic power that his father, Brahma, ordered him to get married and beget children as a householder. Kardama did that also. He begot 9 good daughters and 1 son, Kapila Muni, and thus his householder duty was also performed nicely, and now his duty was to leave. Even though he had the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his son, he had to respect the authority of the Vedas. This is a very important lesson. Even if one has God in his home as his son, he should still follow the Vedic injunctions. It is stated, Mahajano yena gatapasa panta, one should traverse the path which is followed by great personalities. Kardama Muni's example is very instructive, for in spite of having the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his son, he left home just to obey the authority of the Vedic injunction. Kardama Muni states here that the main purpose of his leaving home was while traveling all over the world as a mendicant, he would always remember the Supreme Personality of Godhead within his heart and thereby be freed from all the anxieties of material existence. In this age of Kali Yuga, sannyas is prohibited because persons in this age are all shudras and cannot follow the rules and regulations of sannyas life. It is very commonly found that so-called sannyasis are addicted to nonsense, even to having private relationships with women. This is the abominable situation in this age. Although they dress themselves as sannyasis, they still cannot free themselves from the four principles of sinful life, namely illicit sex life, meat-eating, intoxication, and gambling. Since they are not freed from these four principles, they are cheating in the public by posing as swamis. In Kali Yuga, the injunction is that no one should accept sannyas. Of course, those who actually follow the rules and regulations must take sannyas. Generally, however, people are unable to accept sannyas life, and therefore Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stressed, Kalo nastyeva 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 gatiranita. In this age, there is no other alternative than to chant the holy name of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. The main purpose of sannyas life is to be in constant companionship with the Supreme Lord, either by thinking of him within the heart or hearing of him through oral reception. In this age, hearing is more important than thinking because one's thinking may be disturbed by mental agitation. But if one concentrates on hearing, he will be forced to associate with the sound vibration of Krishna. Krishna and the sound vibration Krishna are none different. So if one loudly vibrates Hare Krishna, then he will be able to think of Krishna immediately. This process of chanting is the best process of self-realization in this age. Therefore, Lord Chaitanya preached it so nicely for the benefit of all humanity. Text 36. My appearance in this world is especially to explain the philosophy of Shankhya, which is highly esteemed for self-realization by those desiring freedom from the entanglement of unnecessary material desires. Purport. Here the word durasayat is very significant. Dur means trouble or dukkha, miseries. Ashayat means shelter, means from the shelter. We conditioned souls have taken shelter of the material body, which is full of troubles and miseries. Foolish people cannot understand the situation, and this is called ignorance, illusion, or the spell of Maya. Human society should very seriously understand that the body itself is the source of all miserable life. Modern civilization is supposed to be making advancement in scientific knowledge. But what is this scientific knowledge? It is based on bodily comforts only, without knowledge of that however comfortably one maintains this body, the body is destructible. As stated in Bhagavad Gita, antavanta ime deha, these bodies are destined to be destroyed. Nitya shokta sharinina refers to the living soul or the spiritual spark which is within the body. That soul is eternal, and the body is not eternal. For our activity, we must have a body. Without a body, without sense organs, there is no activity. But people are not inquiring whether it is possible to have an eternal body. Actually, they aspire for an eternal body because even though they engage in sense enjoyment, that sense enjoyment is not eternal. They are therefore in want of something which they can enjoy eternally, but they do not understand how to attain that perfection. Shankhya philosophy, therefore, as stated herein by Kapiladeva, is tatvanan. The Shankhya philosophy system is designed to afford understanding of the real truth. What is that real truth? The real truth is knowledge of how to get out of the material body, which is the source of all trouble. Lord Kapila's incarnation or descent is specially meant for this purpose. That is clearly stated here. Text 37. This path of self-realization, which is difficult to understand, has now been lost in the course of time. Please know that I have assumed this body of Kapila to introduce and explain this philosophy to human society again. Purport. It is not true that Sankhya philosophy is a new system of philosophy introduced by Kapila as material philosophers introduce new kinds of mental speculative thought to supersede that of another philosopher. On the material platform, everyone, especially the mental speculator, tries to be more prominent than others. The field of activity of the speculators is the mind. There is no limit to the different ways in which one can agitate the mind. The mind can be unlimitedly agitated, and thus one can put forward an unlimited number of theories. Shankhya philosophy is not like that. It is not mental speculation. It is factual. But at the time of Kapila, it was lost. In due course of time, a particular type of knowledge may be lost or may be covered for the time being. That is the nature of this material world. A similar statement was made by Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, Sakalene Kalaneha Mahata Yoga Nashta. Quote, in the course of time, this yoga system, as stated in Bhagavad Gita, was lost. End quote. It was coming in parampara, in disciplic succession, but due to the passage of time, it was lost. The time factor is so pressing that in the course of time, everything within this material world is spoiled or lost. The yoga system of Bhagavad Gita was lost before the meeting of Krishna and Arjuna. Therefore, Krishna enunciated the same ancient yoga system to Arjuna, who could actually understand Bhagavad Gita. Similarly, Kapila also said that the system of Shankhya philosophy was not exactly being introduced by him. It was already current, but in the course of time it was mysteriously lost, and therefore he appeared to reintroduce it. That is the purpose of the incarnation of Godhead. Yada yada hi dharma sya glani bhavati bharata. Dharma means the real occupation of the living entity. When there is a discrepancy in the eternal occupation of the living entity, the Lord comes and introduces the real occupation of life. Any so-called religious system that is not in the line of devotional service is called adharma samstapana. When people forget their eternal relationship with God and engage in something other than devotional service, that is called irreligion. How can one get out of this miserable condition of material life is stated in Shankhya philosophy, and the Lord himself is explaining this sublime system. Text 38. Now, being sanctioned by me, go as you desire, surrendering all your activities to me. Conquering insurmountable death, worship me for eternal life. Purport. The purpose of Shankhya philosophy is stated herein. If anyone wants real eternal life, he has to engage himself in devotional service or Krishna consciousness. To become free from birth and death is not an easy task. Birth and death are natural to this material body. Sudurjaya means very, very difficult to overcome. The modern so-called scientists have no sufficient means to understand the process of victory over birth and death. Therefore, they set aside the question of death and birth. They do not consider it. They simply engage in the problems of the material body, which is transient and sure to end. Actually, human life is meant for conquering the insurmountable process of birth and death. That can be done, as stated here. Mum Bhaja, one must engage in the devotional service of the Lord. In Bhagavad Gita also, the Lord says, Manmana Bhava Mad Bhakta, just become my devotee, just worship me, end quote. But foolish so-called scholars say that it is not to Krishna whom we must worship and to whom we must surrender. It is something else. Without Krishna's mercy, therefore, no one can understand the Shankya philosophy or any philosophy which is especially meant for liberation. Vedic knowledge confirms that one becomes entangled in this material life because of ignorance, and one can become free from material embarrassment by becoming situated in factual knowledge. Shankya means that factual knowledge by which one can get out of this material entanglement. Text 39. Always, in your own heart, through your intellect, seeing me, the supreme self-effulgent soul dwelling within the hearts of all living entities, you will achieve the state of eternal life, free from all lamentation and fear. Purport. People are very anxious to understand the absolute truth in various ways, especially by experiencing the Brahma Jyoti, or Brahman effulgence, by meditation and by mental speculation. But Kapila Dev uses the word mam to emphasize that the personality of Godhead is the ultimate feature of the absolute truth. In Bhagavad Gita, the personality of Godhead always says, mam, unto me. But the rascals misinterpret the clear meaning. Mam is the supreme personality of Godhead. If one can see the supreme personality of Godhead as he appears in different incarnations and understand that he has not assumed a material body, but is present in his own eternal spiritual form, then he can understand the nature of the personality of Godhead. Since the less intelligent cannot understand this point, it is stressed everywhere again and again. Simply by seeing the form of the Lord as he presents himself by his own internal potency as Krishna or Rama or Kapila, one can directly see the Brahma Jyoti because the Brahma Jyoti is no more than the effulgence of his bodily luster. Since the sunshine is the luster of the sun planet, by seeing the sun, one automatically sees the sunshine. Similarly, by seeing the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one simultaneously sees and experiences the Paramatma feature as well as the impersonal Brahman feature of the Supreme. The Bhagavatam has already enunciated that the absolute truth is present in three features: in the beginning as the impersonal Brahman, in the next stage as the Paramatma in everyone's heart, and at last as the ultimate realization of the absolute truth, Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One who sees the Supreme Person can automatically realize the other features, namely Paramatma and Brahman, features of the Lord. The words used here are Vishikho Bhayam Richasi. Simply by seeing the Personality of Godhead, one realizes everything, and the result is that he becomes situated on the platform where there is no lamentation and no fear. This can be attained simply by devotional service to this Personality of Godhead. Text 40. I shall also describe this sublime knowledge, which is the door to spiritual life, to my mother, so that she also can attain perfection and self-realization, ending all reactions to furtive activities. Thus she will also be freed from all material fear. Purport. Kardama Muni was anxious about his good wife Devahuti while leaving home, and so the worthy son promised that not only would Kardama Muni be free from the material entanglement, but Devahuti would also be freed by receiving instruction from her son. A very good example is set here. The husband goes away, taking the sannyasa order for self-realization, but his representative, the son, who is equally educated, remains at home to deliver the mother. A sannyasi is not supposed to take his wife with him. At the vanaprastha stage of retired life, in the stage midway between household life and renounced life, one may keep his wife as an assistant without sex relations, but in the sannyasa order of life, one cannot keep his wife with him. Otherwise, a person like Kardama Muni would have kept his wife with him, and there would have been no hindrance to his prosecution of self-realization. Kardama Muni followed the Vedic injunction that no one in sannyasa life can have any kind of relationship with women. But what is the position of a woman who is left by her husband? She is entrusted to the son, and the son promises that he will deliver his mother from entanglement. A woman is not supposed to take sannyas. The so-called spiritual societies concocted in modern times give sannyas even to women, although there is no sanction in the Vedic literature for a woman's accepting sannyas. Otherwise, if it were sanctioned, Kardama Muni would have taken his wife and given her sannyas. The woman must remain at home. She has only three stages of dependency: dependency on the father in childhood, dependency on the husband in youth, and in old age, dependency on the grown-up son, such as Kapila. In old age, the process of women depends on the grown-up son. The ideal son, Kapila Muni, is assuring his father of the deliverance of his mother so that his father may go peacefully without anxiety for his good wife. Text 41. Sri Maitreya said, "Thus, when Kardama Muni, the progenitor of human society, was spoken to in fullness by his son, Kapila, he circumambulated him, and with a good, pacified mind, he left at once for the forest." Purport. Going to the forest is compulsory for everyone. It is not a mental excursion upon which one person goes and another does not. Everyone should go to the forest at least for as a vanaprast. Forest going means to take 100% shelter of the Supreme Lord, as explained by Prahlad Maharaj in his talks with his father. Sada samudvigna diam. People who have accepted a temporary material body are always full of anxieties. One should not, therefore, be very much afraid by this or affected by this material body, but should try to be freed. The preliminary process to become freed is to go to the forest, to give up family relationships, and exclusively engage in Krishna consciousness. That is the purpose of going to the forest. Otherwise, the forest is only a place for monkeys and wild animals. To go to the forest does not mean to become a monkey or a ferocious animal. It means to accept exclusively the shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and engage oneself in full service. One does not actually have to go to the forest. At the present moment, this is not at all advisable for a man who has spent his life all along in big cities. As explained by Prahlad Maharaj, hit vatma patim gayam agriham andakupam. One should not remain, but always engaged in the responsibilities of family life, because family life without Krishna consciousness is just like a blind well. Alone in a field, if one falls into a blind well and no one is there to save him, he may cry for years and no one will see or hear where the crying is coming from. Death is sure. Similarly, those who are forgetful of their eternal relationship with the Supreme Lord are in the blind well of family life. Their possession is very ominous. Prahlad Maharaj advised that one should give up this well somehow or other and take to Krishna consciousness and thus be freed from material entanglement, which is full of anxieties. Text 42. The sage Kardama Muni accepted silence as a vow in order to think of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and take shelter of him exclusively. Without association, he traveled over the surface of the globe as a sannyasi, devoid of any relationship with fire or shelter. Purport. Here the words anagnir aniketana are very significant. A sannyasi should be completely detached from fire and any residential quarters. A grihastha has a relationship with fire, either for offering sacrifices or for cooking, but a sannyasi is freed from these two responsibilities. He does not have to cook or offer fire for sacrifice because he is always engaged in Krishna consciousness. Therefore, he has already accomplished all ritualistic performances of religion. Aniketana means without lodging. He should not have his own house, but he should depend completely on the Supreme Lord for his food and lodging. He should travel. Mona means silence. Unless one becomes silent, we cannot think completely about the pastimes and activities of the Lord. It is not that because one is a fool and cannot speak nicely, he therefore takes the vow of Mona. Rather, one becomes silent so that people will not disturb him. It is said by Chanakya Pandit that a rascal appears very intelligent as long as he does not speak. But speaking is the test. The so-called silence of a silent, impersonalist Swami indicates that he has nothing to say. He simply wants to beg. But the silence adopted by Kardama Muni is not like that. He became silent for relief from nonsensical talk. One is called a Muni when he remains grave and does not talk nonsense. Maharaj Ambarish has set a very good example. Whenever he spoke about the pastimes of the Lord. Mauna necessitates refraining from nonsensical talk and engaging the talking facility in the pastimes of the Lord. In that way, one can chant and hear about the Lord in order to perfect his life. Vratam means that one should take a vow, as explained in Bhagavad Gita. Amanitvam adambitvam, without hankering for personal respect and without being proud of one's material position. Ahimsa means not being violent. There are 18 processes for attaining knowledge and perfection, and by his vow, Kardama Muni adopted all the principles of self-realization. Text 43. He fixed his mind upon the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Param Brahman, who is beyond cause and effect, who maintains the three modes of material nature, who is beyond those three modes, and who is perceived only by unfailing devotional service. Purport. Whenever there is bhakti, there must be three things present: the devotee, the devotion, and the Lord. Without these three, bhakta, bhakti, and bhagavan, there is no meaning to the word bhakti. Kardama Muni fixed his mind on the Supreme Brahman and realized him through bhakti, or devotional service. This indicates that he fixed his mind on the personal feature of the Lord, because bhakti cannot be executed unless one has realization of the personal features of the Absolute Truth. Gunavabhase. He is beyond the three modes of material nature. But it is due to him that the three modes of material nature are manifested. In other words, although the material nature is an emanation of the Supreme Lord, he is not affected as we are by the modes of material nature. We are conditioned souls, but he is not affected, although the material nature has emanated from him. He is the supreme living entity and is never affected by Maya, but we are subordinate, minute living entities prone to be affected by the limitations of Maya. If he is in constant contact with the Supreme Lord by devotional service, the conditioned living entity also becomes free from the infection of Maya. This is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, Sagunan Samatityaitan. A person engaged in Krishna consciousness is at once liberated from the influence of the three modes of material nature. In other words, once the conditioned soul engages himself in devotional service, he also becomes liberated like the Lord. Text 44. Thus, he gradually became unaffected by the false ego of material identity and became free from material affection. Undisturbed, equal to everyone, and without duality, he could indeed see himself also. His mind was turned inward and was perfectly calm, like an ocean unagitated by waves. Purport. When one's mind is in full Krishna consciousness and one fully engages in rendering devotional service to the Lord, he becomes just like an ocean unagitated by waves. This very example is also cited in Bhagavad Gita. One should become like the ocean. The ocean is filled by many thousands of rivers, and clouds evaporate millions of tons of its water, yet the ocean is the same unagitated ocean. The laws of nature may work, but if one is fixed in devotional service at the lotus feet of the Lord, he is not agitated because he is introspective. He does not look outside to material nature, but he looks into the spiritual nature of his existence with a sober mind. He simply engages in the service of the Lord. Thus, he realizes his own self without false identification with matter and without affection for material possessions. Such a great devotee is never in trouble with others because he sees everyone from the platform of spiritual understanding. He sees himself and others in the right perspective. Text 45. He thus became liberated from conditioned life and became self-situated in transcendental devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudev, the omniscient supersoul within everyone. Purport. When one engages in the transcendental devotional service of the Lord, he becomes aware that his constitutional position as an individual soul is to be eternally a servitor of the Supreme Lord Vasudeva. Self-realization does not mean that because the Supreme Soul and the individual soul are both souls, they are equal in every respect. The individual soul is prone to be conditioned, and the Supreme Soul is never conditioned. When the conditioned soul realizes that he is subordinate to the Supreme Soul, that is called labdhavatma, or self-realization, or muktabandhana, or freedom from material contamination. Material contamination continues as long as one thinks that he is as good as the Supreme Lord is, or is equal with him. This condition is the last snare of Maya. Maya always influences the conditioned soul. Even after much meditation and speculation, if one continues to think himself one with the Supreme Lord, it is to be understood that he is still in the last snares of the spell of Maya. The word prana is very significant. Para means transcendental, untinged by material contamination. When one is in full consciousness that he is an eternal servant of the Lord, that is called para bhakti. If one has any identification with material things and executes devotional service for attainment of some material gain, that is vita bhakti, contaminated bhakti. One can actually become liberated by execution of para bhakti. Another word mentioned here is sarvajñe. The supersoul sitting within the heart is all cognizant. He knows. I may forget my past activities due to the change of body, but because the Supreme Lord as Paramatma is sitting with me, he knows everything. Therefore, the result of my past karma or past activities is awarded to me. I may forget, but he awards me suffering or enjoyment for the misdeeds or good deeds of my past life. One should not think that he's freed from reaction because he has forgotten the actions of his past life. Reactions will take place, and what kinds of reactions there will be is judged by the supersoul, the witness. Text 46. He began to see that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is seated in everyone's heart and that everyone is existing on him because he is the supersoul of everyone. Purport. That everyone is existing on the Supreme Personality of Godhead does not mean that everyone is also Godhead. This is also explained in Bhagavad Gita. Everything is resting on him, the Supreme Lord, but that does not mean that the Supreme Lord is also everywhere. This mysterious position has to be understood by highly advanced devotees. There are three kinds of devotees: neophyte devotee, intermediate devotee, and advanced devotee. Neophyte devotee does not understand the techniques of devotional science, but simply offers devotional service to the deity in the temple. The intermediate devotee, who understands who God is, who is a devotee and who is a non-devotee and who is innocent, and he deals with such persons differently. But a person who sees that the Lord is sitting as Paramatma in everyone's heart and that everything is depending or existing on the transcendental energy of the Supreme Lord is in the highest devotional position. Text 47. Freed from all hatred and desire, Kardama Muni, being equal to everyone because of discharging uncontaminated devotional service, immediately attained the path back to Godhead. Purport. As stated in Bhagavad Gita, only by devotional service can one understand the transcendental nature of the Supreme Lord, and after understanding him perfectly in his transcendental position, enter into the kingdom of God. The process of entering into the kingdom of God is Tripad Bhutigati, or the path back home, back to Godhead, by which one can attain the ultimate goal of life. Kardama Muni, by his perfect devotional service and service, achieved this ultimate goal, which is known as Bhagavati Gati. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the third canto, 24th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Renunciation of Kardama Muni.